In this native speaker listening challenge, you're going to hear my friend explain what a sprinkle is. Remember, the first time, just relax and listen to it. The second time, you're going to listen and read along. This will help you measure your understanding. If you understood 50% or 90%, it will help you gauge how much more you need to improve. And the third time, we're going to break it down line by line, and I'm going to share with you some highlights of every section that you can apply to your speaking skills.
What's a sprinkle?
Okay, so a sprinkle is a baby shower for baby number two. So the mama had the one baby, and now the mama's having the second baby. And normally there's a few years apart or a gender difference. So if the first baby was a boy and the second's a girl, then you call the second shower a sprinkle, because the first baby, you shower them with gifts. The second party, you only sprinkle them with gifts because they already have some of the gifts. And then the third one, there's just no shower.
What's a sprinkle?
Okay, so a sprinkle is a baby shower for baby number two. So the mama had the one baby, and now the mama's having the second baby. And normally there's a few years apart or a gender difference. So if the first baby was a boy and the second's a girl, then you call the second shower a sprinkle, because the first baby, you shower them with gifts. The second party, you only sprinkle them with gifts because they already have some of the gifts. And then the third one, there's just no shower.
What's a sprinkle?
Okay, so a sprinkle is a baby shower for baby number two.
Notice how she begins. Okay, so a sprinkle. Using these filler words, or just words to give you a little time to get your thoughts together, allows you not only to, again, have extra time, it also allows you to sound more natural. Also, notice how she reduces for to fur, for baby number two.
What's a sprinkle?
Okay, so a sprinkle is a baby shower for baby number two. So the mama had the one baby, and now the mama's having the second baby.
All right, so for this section, notice that she drops the D in and, so it sounds like and now, and she also totally drops the G in having, so now it sounds like havin'. You'll hear this a lot in casual American English. Havin', goin', sometimes we do the kind of half G, like swimming, it's the G stops. You don't go swimming, just swimming, but in this case, it's totally dropped, and it's totally common.
So the mama had the one baby, and now the mama's having the second baby. And normally there's a few years apart or a gender difference.
So many great examples of linking. Okay, so here we have there's a few years, so really say this sentence and make sure that you're linking all of those, and it will help you sound much smoother.
And normally there's a few years apart or a gender difference. So if the first baby was a boy and the second's a girl, then you call the second shower a sprinkle, because the first baby, you shower them with gifts.
In this section, I love the way she uses emphasis to make her point and to show contrast. If you notice, she says, you call the second shower a sprinkle because the first baby, you shower them with gifts. Those of you who don't know, in the U.S. and in many other countries, they have a custom of throwing a baby shower, which is a party, when you're expecting your first child. Now in this case, she's describing a sprinkle, which in the US is the party that we have for when people have a second child. So that's why she highlights that one you sprinkle and one you shower. Also, it's kind of a play on words. A baby shower is to shower the mother or the parents with gifts. So not the shower like the storm or raining, but rather to shower someone with gifts. It means to give them a lot of gifts. Now a sprinkle, tying back to weather, is when it's a light rain. So a sprinkle shower is when you have a few gifts. So these are expressions that we use to describe parties for when you're having babies in the US.
So if the first baby was a boy and the second's a girl, then you call the second shower a sprinkle, because the first baby, you shower them with gifts. The second party, you only sprinkle them with gifts because they already have some of the gifts.
In this section, I really like the way she uses a kind of melodic intonation to highlight the different sections of the point of the sentence. So this is something I want you to listen to and try to imitate. And when you use this kind of intonation flexibility, it really helps you just break down information that can be difficult to follow. The other thing I want you to notice is that she says "'cause" instead of "because". This is very casual English and quite common. So it's not cause, like cause and effect, but cause. So when you hear cause in this context, it means because.
The second party, you only sprinkle them with gifts because they already have some of the gifts. And then the third one, there's just no shower.
In this case, she uses intonation to signify the end of her explanation. She didn't say, and that's what it means, or this is the conclusion. That kind of phrasing can sound very formal. And remember, you're not writing an essay. You're just chatting. You're talking. So notice how her tone is very conclusive, right? Like at the end, it's just very matter of fact. And you understand because of her tone that there's no more.
And then the third one, there's just no shower.
It's really important when you're communicating in English, not only to use your body language, but also intonation. Of course, pronunciation is amazing and it's why you're here. But intonation in conjunction with pronunciation really helps you communicate more effectively. So these are the things I want you to start noticing. And I totally know that she is a very fast speaker, but that's why I wanted to include real life examples in this course. When I speak, I have a tendency to speak clearly because I'm an educator and because I love you. But whenever I use examples from real life conversations that I have with my friends who are all native speakers, it gives you the opportunity to really feel what it's going to be like in the real world. The purpose is not for you to feel intimidated or overwhelmed, but rather empowered that you have the opportunity to be exposed to it in this kind of way that I then break down for you, and you start, again, remember, this is all about pattern recognition, which builds confidence and helps you feel more comfortable. Let me know in the comments if you have any questions, or tell me what other conversations you'd like me to include in this course. This activity is part of my Advanced American English Pronunciation course. Check out the course link in the video notes below and let me know in the comments what other topics you'd like to hear native speakers talking about.